Namo Vishnupadaya, Krishna Prishthaya Bhutle, Srimate Bhaktivedanta, Swami Itinamine. Namaste Saraswati Deve, Gauravani Pracharine, Nirvishesha Shunyavadi, Paschate Desha Tarine. Hare Krishna, my name is Tapan Mishra Das, and I serve at the ISKCON Ministry of Education. We are celebrating a week of how to read Srila Prabhupada's books, making Srila Prabhupada's books the very basis of our personal spiritual life and of this movement. Today, we have the pleasure of the very auspicious company of His Holiness Yadunandan Maharaj. His Holiness is a renowned teacher, he's the sannyasi, he travels, and he's taught many, many students during his service within ISKCON. So I'd like to welcome, on behalf of all the viewers, His Holiness Yadunandan Maharaj.
Hare Krishna. Thank you very much.
Please accept my humble obeisances. Vancha kalpatarubhya shakripa sindhu bhevacha. Patita nam pavanebhyo.
Vaishnavebhyo namo namaha.
Maharaj, thank you for taking out the time to speak to us today.
It's my pleasure. Thank you very much, Tapanamishra Prabhu, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to share whatever little I have to share.
Maharaj, I'm sure all of us are going to be enlivened by what we're going to hear from you. We want to start our journey today to know from you, what was your first encounter with Srila Prabhupada's books?
This happened in 1977, when I was 14 years old. Through some friends, we had a group of study of parapsychology and UFOs. And then through this group, we started to practice yoga. So my friends, two of my friends, started to visit the temple in Barcelona, in Spain, and they introduced me to Krishna consciousness. They brought one Bhagavad Gita CDs in French language, because there were not so many books in Spanish at the time, at least in Spain. Maybe in the US and Mexico, there were books prior to that. But in Spain was the beginning of the movement, because it was after the dictatorship of Franco. So it was the beginning of democracy after 40 years of dictatorship. So the books started to come to Spain slowly.
Maharaj, who gave you the first book?
The name of my friend was Juan Manel. And then later on, he took initiation as Jagannath Mishra Das. So Jagannath Mishra Prabhu gave me the book as a youth friend at the time.
And was he a practicing devotee himself, engaged in some practice of sadhana?
He was living at home with his parents, and he was practicing a little bit. He was chanting. He was the most serious of the lot of the devotees. And later on, he joined the temple. He committed himself.
Maharaj, I presume that you know many languages and you knew French as well. When you received this book, what was it that inspired you to actually read? Because the Bhagavad Gita, as it is a fairly intricate, complex philosophy book as it is.
Yes, actually, the Bhagavad Gita in French, I was not able to read it very well, because my knowledge of French was too small. But I got also, I don't remember if this book was given to me by Jagannath Mishra or by someone else of my friends, that I forgot. But the first volume of the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, softbound, came to my home somehow. And that was the most inspiring section of Srila Prabhupada's books I was reading particularly, the introduction in which Srila Prabhupada describes the submarine life of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu.
Yes. Well, I always found it so inspiring that within Srimad Bhagavatam book, Srila Prabhupada has actually captured the person Bhagavata as represented by the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself when we read the introduction. So to me, it was quite inspiring in some way. I was moved that here is the introduction of Srimad Bhagavatam and Srila Prabhupada is writing in great details about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Maharaj, are there any specific sections from your first reading that you still carry in your heart, which moved you forward in the spiritual life?
For me, it was the life of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. I was reading it again and again and again. So I'm looking at the pictures. This captured completely my heart. So I still, it's there, the remembrances of the descriptions Srila Prabhupada gives of many of the lilas of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in such a short, powerful description of them.
Maharaj, it's been now, about 43 years for you in your relationship with the movement and with Srila Prabhupada's books. Could you share with us how has reading Srila Prabhupada's books every day or regularly impacted your personal spiritual life?
Reading Srila Prabhupada's books has made up my personal spiritual life. I won't be here if I would have not been reading regularly Srila Prabhupada's books. That's for sure. It's totally clear for me. This happened when I was a young man living in the temple, still a teenager. Naturally, as a teenager, I was feeling there are many desires. The body develops the hormones of the youth and feeling desires to enjoy material life. But because I read Srila Prabhupada's books 1 hour a day in a systematic way, that gave me sustainable spiritual strength to continue practicing Krishna consciousness. Otherwise, I don't think I will be here. For me, it's very clear.
Maharaj, you mentioned that you're reading 1 hour every day, even as a young temple resident and sadhaka. Did I hear that right? That every day you're reading Prabhupada's books?
Yes. At the moment, I target for 1 hour. And yes. Sometimes I read more, sometimes I read less. The principle is to every day read. That's the principle. So as a young man, it was easier because I had less responsibilities. So it helped me to build up the knowledge and the values given by Srila Prabhupada and to put them into practice in my personal life. Now at the moment, I'm harvesting many of the fruits of all this period. And in order to keep it sustainable, it is essential, the reading. So I read every day, target for 1 hour. Sometimes I make it, sometimes I don't make it. Like for example, last night, I made 1 hour in order to finish. I went to bed late because some people called me with an emergency. Somebody died, was a whole thing. But I thought I should finish my reading time. So I went to bed a little bit later and it was very fulfilling to complete the daily reading. This morning I did it before because this afternoon I'm teaching a course for new devotees. And we have a meeting for the development of the school here in New Prajamandala in Spain, where I am now. So like that, the main thing is to make it a priority. That's the main thing.
Yes, Maharaj. Maharaj, you mentioned that you use two words, knowledge and values, which sustain us. Maharaj, in your experience, when one starts reading, at what point in our life, spiritual life, does the reading transform from knowledge to value? And how should we read for this transformation to happen so that we can also get the same kind of protection and shelter that you received in your spiritual life?
My experience is that knowledge and values in Srila Prabhupada's books goes on in an integrated way as long as we practice daily sadhana. That's very important. We need to practice daily sadhana and do it in sadhu sangha, in Vaishnava association. Of course, if it's not possible to do it because someone is living far from the temple, then should do it somehow, keep sadhu sangha. For me, that's most important. In my case, I decided to live in temples because it makes it easier to do that. But also from home, in the family, one can do it with the family members. Nowadays, with internet, in the early years, we didn't have internet. But nowadays, we can also share through internet. Like this, during the lockdown, we were having courses here in New Prajamandala on Bhakti Shastri, and some devotees from Peru, from Mexico, from Colombia were participating. So we were reading together through internet. We were using the Facebook platform. So devotees were following and commenting by writing their whatever questions they had or comments. And we were combining the reading of Srila Prabhupada's books with the classes. I found that a way also of keep up with the regular amount of time I wanted to read per day. So yes, we combined reading the books and then teaching the class.
Maharaj, how important have you found reading, and what is its impact in the preaching that you undertake?
I won't be able to preach without reading Prabhupada's books. What will I be talking to people about? I mean, I will talk any imagination I have, but by sustaining my preaching and Srila Prabhupada's teachings, then I can rest assured that what I'm communicating is approved by the Guru Parampara, by the Lord. So, of course, there is the personal experience, because if there is no personal experience, also there is no substance in the message of the books. I mean to say that we need to apply the books in order, as you were asking before, in order to acquire the values. And very important point that I just read 1 hour ago, I'm reading now the 15th chapter of the 7th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. And just in a purport, Srila Prabhupada writes that reading without faith in the spiritual master will not produce fruit. And we find this also in the last verse of the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, Yasya Deve Para Bhaktir Yata Deve Tata Gurau. Unless we have faith in Guru and Krishna, we won't get the access to the secrets of Shastra of the transcendental knowledge we are reading or receiving. So it's very important that we read with an open heart. That's most important.
Well, that's a very beautiful aspect of the mood of reading that you just touched upon, that we should have proper attitude and our relationship with Guru and Krishna should be intact. Sometimes while reading, devotees have a tendency to acquire knowledge for the sake of consumption. We also, not often, but sometimes we come across a situation where devotees want to, you know, identify esoteric points, some specific points, which in their lectures or in the preaching, they can highlight to others things that people may not have heard. Maharaj, on the aspect of mood, what are the other things that you would like to share with us that we should, as practitioners, we should adopt in the mood of reading?
Yeah, the mood of reading should be a mood of service. We're doing service to His Divine Grace, Srila Prabhupada, to the Srimad Bhagavatam, to the Bhagavad Gita, the sacred, most sacred words of the Lord. So we are serving the Lord and His devotees by reading. That's one aspect. And another aspect is that also what I find very useful in my personal life is to share what I learn, what I read, share it with others. But it's important, as you were mentioning, not to do it with the idea of show off others how much I know about the books, because this will go against the spirit of Srimad Bhagavatam. Like, for example, in this section, I'm preparing because next week I'll have the honor of teaching online some chapters of the seventh canto for the VHC, the Vrindavan Institute for Higher Education. So yes. I was reading again these chapters in order to refresh and be prepared for the teaching, in order to have it fresh. It's good to go back and read again and again the books.
Yes.
So in one of the sections, the Bhagavatam states that the sannyasi, and that's extended to any devotee, because as Srila Prabhupada explains in many parts of his books, the spirit of renunciation is there for each and every devotee. Like the first verse of chapter 6 of Gita, anashrita karma palam karyam karma karoti yaha sa sanyasi cha yogi cha nani raknir na chakriyaha. That a true sannyasi is not someone who externally becomes a sannyasi, but actually anyone who performs his or her duty according to proper attitude, according to what's meant to be done, with a spirit of detachment and a spirit of service. So if we do, and in that section of the Bhagavatam, the Bhagavatam and then Srila Prabhupada comments on it, that we shouldn't just study many books for the sake of showing off. A sannyasi should not be attached to learning many things for the sake of erudition, but as service, then it's very good that we learn.
So we should all maintain that mood of service, and we should maintain our sanctity in the relationship with Guru and Krishna, and within the association of Vaishnavas are the four points that you kindly highlighted to us today, Maharaj. Maharaj, I want to ask you something more. It is often mentioned that we should use Shastra Chakshu, this word, that we should view the world through the eyes of the scriptures. We should live our lives through the eyes of the scriptures. In your decades of service and practicing of Krishna consciousness, can you share with us some personal experiences of what does it really mean for some of us to understand this word, Shastra Chakshu?
Yeah, basically it means that the heart becomes cleansed by the process of hearing and chanting, and then we can see. It is not something intellectual that we want to see. Of course, I mean, first we may do it theoretically, like, for example, when we say, I'm not this body, we hear the message of Srila Prabhupada again and again. And first we understand it theoretically, and we may endeavor to see in this way. But it actually, we see it like this when our heart becomes cleansed by the practice of devotional service. It's like a car when the if for example in some countries when it gets very cold in the winter, there is ice in front of the car. So we need to clean the ice in order to be able to drive. Or if it is dirty, we need to clean the dirt. So that's my realization, that we need to clean the heart in order to see. And then if we see it, and therefore we need to do it on a daily basis, because the nature of this world is that dust accumulates again. If we don't keep cleaning every day, it's like a room. If we don't clean the room every day, it will get dirty. So when it is clean, then we can see it in a very natural way. Does that make sense?
Thank you, Maharaj. Yes, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I mean, clarity of vision goes along with clarity of heart. And one without the other would be incomplete. That's the message that we summarize from what you shared with us now. Maharaj, it is mentioned that Srila Prabhupada lives forever through his Bhaktivedanta purports and his books. Is there something that you can share with us of your own experience of this statement?
My relationship with Srila Prabhupada is through his Bhaktivedanta purports. Of course, we have also the videos. We have the wonderful Sangha of those fortunate direct disciples of Srila Prabhupada who transmit so much personal experiences, both Bapu and Bani experiences they had during his personal physical presence. But in my case, my main link with Srila Prabhupada is through his books. And therefore, to me, it makes total sense, the underlinement made by the GBC body, that Srila Prabhupada is not just the founder acharya of ISKCON, but also the preeminent Shiksha Guru. So it is not a formal position, but what makes it more relevant into my life and into the life of all the devotees is that we are building up our Krishna consciousness on the basis of Srila Prabhupada's instructions. It is by his mercy that we can grow in Krishna consciousness. We can sustain our spiritual lives.
Maharaj, it would seem quite hypocritical if we continue to use the word that Srila Prabhupada is the founder acharya, he's the preeminent Shiksha Guru, but if you were to not read his books, then they're just beating empty drums. What does it really mean? So yes, I think from your words, we understand that if we really want to substantiate those statements, then we must read, understand, and establish this relationship through the Bhaktivedanta purports. Mm. Maharaj, what are the benefits of reading these books? You know, okay, spiritual life. How can we quantify, how can we visualize, see, experience the benefit of reading Prabhupada's books every day?
We get inspiration for practicing the process of devotional service, daily sadhana, for associating with devotees. Like yesterday, we were starting a course here in New Brajamandala. We started yesterday. We have a group of 9 students and new devotees, most of them. One or two are already some time and they want to also join the course. And some of these devotees were sharing their experience to break the ice, which we share each of us how we came in contact with ISKCON and why we came together for this course. And one of the students was sharing how, I think it was a lady devotee, how she came to associate with devotees because she was reading Srila Prabhupada's books. And then Prabhupada was saying, associate with devotees, associate with devotees. So finally she went to search for the devotees. So this is one of the benefits that we will get inspiration to practice the process of devotional service. Another aspect is that our taste for bhakti, for serving Krishna, will increase. And as a consequence of this, our material desires will diminish. So there are so many benefits. And like that, we establish a sound foundation for life in Krishna consciousness.
Indeed, Maharaj. Initially in our conversation, you also talked about how it gave the protection and the shelter by just reading every day, translating the knowledge into values and giving the strength and character to be able to sustain through this whole journey of life, which definitely offers us a lot of bumpy rides every now and then.
Yeah, I like also to express my gratitude to His Holiness Keshavabharati Maharaj, who, since I knew him in the early 80s, he was preaching here in Spain, he was my big source of inspiration to read Srila Prabhupada's books 1 hour a day. He was who inspired me during a book distribution marathon where I was struggling with, I was the cook for the Sankirtan party. So I was struggling with cooking, wanted to go out on book distribution, but had too many things on my plate and didn't manage to read. And Maharaj told me, no, you focus on reading every day Srila Prabhupada's books, 1 hour, then you will be able to serve very nice devotees. Then the book distributors will be so much inspired and they will distribute many more books. And this will be your share of book distribution. So
yes, Maharaj.
I was able to distribute books by reading Srila Prabhupada's books. Of course, we should do both.
Yes.
I like also to share a recent anecdote on distributing Srila Prabhupada's books, if I may.
Yes, please.
I went recently to Sweden for a few days. It was a ticket already was there. And we're starting to carefully traveling within Europe, taking some precautions for the COVID and so on. So one of the attendants in the flight attendants asked me why I was dressed like that. Mm-hmm. So then it happened that during the lockdown, she started to read the spiritual books. So like different books on yoga, Ayurveda, in her search. And she expressed great interest. So I had the book was carrying with me Srila Prabhupada's summarized biography, the BBT book, in a small size, pocket size. It's easier to carry in the bag for distributing, and chant and be happy. So I gave her the books and she promised she will visit us in the temple here in Madrid and New Brajamandala. Mm.
Anyway, very inspiring, Maharaj.
A little digression, but it's good we do both. We read the books and we carry the books with us so that we can share them with people we will be meeting.
That is true, Maharaj. As one of the inspiring speakers in ISKCON and devotee says, do not become only a bookworm. You must practice, imbibe in your character, but also distribute this transcendental literature. And Keshav Bharati Maharaj has been so kind to inspire all of us. I'd like to share with you, Maharaj, that along with Keshav Bharati Maharaj, now we made available the complete reading of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam at the Ministry of Education website, where individual devotees can register and they can go through systematic. Even if they can't read, they can hear all the purports and translations sequentially. It's in English. It's available for everybody who wants to use. And even if we stop somewhere, next time when we log in, it will tell us which was the chapter we left and we can continue our study from there.
That's an excellent service the Ministry of Education is doing, because this will allow sometimes, I know because I'm a busy person within, in this case, in leadership within the movement, but also devotees, sometimes they have to juggle with their family responsibilities, their professional responsibilities, their sadhana, so many different activities. So to be able to listen to the books while, for example, when they travel, even in the car, they are going to work, they can be listening to Srila Prabhupada's translations and purports. Thank you very much for arranging this.
Oh, no. Thank you to your inspiration, Keshav Bharati Maharaj's inspiration. We're just trying to, make that available. On this note, Maharaj, you just now touched upon the note of how busy the leaders are. And of course, there are infinite services to perform within ISKCON. And it's natural that when we're performing services, we get overwhelmed and may not read Prabhupada's books. How important do you think it is for leaders to read Srila Prabhupada's books?
It is essential. If leaders don't read Srila Prabhupada's books, they will fall down. This is what Srila Prabhupada states, and this is what we have seen over the years by experience. Of course, we will need to do a study on to what extent they were reading, but certainly not reading for an extended period of time, it is like not eating. If someone doesn't eat, we'll get weak, we'll get ill, and finally we'll, taking it to the extreme, we'll die. And I like to
That's
share...
That's a beautiful analogy. Beautiful analogy, Maharaj, that you just gave of, reading every day is almost like eating every day. And Srila Prabhupada, in his famous purport in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila 25th chapter 279, he says that if you don't read, then you eat, sleep, and fall down. Maharaj, I want to ask you something.
I have it here. May I?
Yes.
may I share it?
Please, Maharaj, please.
I thought it's not very long. So the translation of Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami is... verse, it's actually, it's Madhya Lila chapter 25, text 278. Men become strong and stout by eating sufficient grains, but the devotee who simply eats ordinary grains but does not taste the transcendental pastimes of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Krishna gradually becomes weak and falls down from their transcendental position. However, if one drinks but a drop of the nectar of Krishna's pastimes, his body and mind begin to bloom, and he begins to laugh, sing, and dance. And Srila Prabhupada, in a very short but super powerful purport, states, all the devotees, and this will include naturally the leaders are first, meaning they should teach by example. Example is better than precept, Srila Prabhupada could say. All the devotees connected with this Krishna consciousness movement must read all the books that have been translated. Chaitanya Charitamrita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, and others. Otherwise, after some time, they will simply eat, sleep, and fall down from their position. Thus, they will miss the opportunity to attain an eternal blissful life of transcendental pleasure.
Maharaj, I would like to share with everybody that you've compiled this research and book on sannyas in modernity. When it comes to leaders in the spiritual order, the sannyasis are the topmost leaders of the spiritual order. And in your research, your discussions with the various sannyasis who are part of the movement or some who left, did you find any relationship between reading Prabhupada's books or hearing Prabhupada's instructions vis-a-vis how the lives took a different turn? If there's something that you may think could be relevant.
Yes, yes. One of the factors for success in that the interviewees were sharing both sannyasis and ex-sannyasis was the higher taste. And reading Srila Prabhupada's books, as we were discussing previously, is very much connected to experiencing the higher taste. We should remember, like for example, the metaphor used by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in his teachings to Srila Rupa Goswami, the metaphor of the Bhakti Lata beach.
Yes.
So the irrigating the seed of bhakti is performed through hearing and chanting and reading. Yes. Reading is a form of hearing.
Yes.
Srila Prabhupada was dictating his purpose, and then we read it in writing, but actually we're hearing Srila Prabhupada's teachings while we read. And many times we read aloud for the benefit of others as well. What I do sometimes, when I travel by car from one place to another, I usually read to the driver. Of course, I read for myself as well. But I ask the driver, do you like to hear? And usually they say yes. They never say no, they always say yes. So then I read aloud, and that's very pleasing for everyone traveling in the car.
Well, Maharaj, that analogy again is very touching analogy. It seems like a journey of life could be a very smooth journey if we were to continue to read and hear and share with each other the topics about Sri Krishna as given in the Bhaktivedanta purports. And sometimes even this long and tiring journey can easily pass just by doing what you gave in the form of an analogy now.
Yes, and if it is natural because life, it's a relatively long journey. When obstacles appear in a very long journey, there may be tiredness, there may be different situations or tests that may put some challenge for our spiritual life. When we are reading Srila Prabhupada's books, we are equipped to respond properly to the challenges. But if we are not prepared, we're not reading, when the challenge comes, we don't have any weapons or any proper responses to give to the challenge we are facing. So that's very important to be prepared, because things happen in life. Sometimes we may lose a dear person, can be a family member, can be a devotee friend. So many things may happen. The departure of the spiritual master, so many things are there which are very tough.
Yes.
If we are reading the books, we will find the answers to respond to the challenge we are facing at the moment.
And on that note, often devotees have stated that when they're facing some struggles in life, seeking for some answers, the moment they open Srila Prabhupada books, it seems like the answer is right in front of them. Is it something that you can share from your own life, some challenges and how they immediately the answers appeared while you were taking shelter of Srila Prabhupada's books?
I mean, practically, what we need to do Like nowadays in the devotee community, sometimes we train devotees also in human skills that can be used in Krishna's service. And one of the skills is the empathic listening, to listen with empathy. So if we listen with empathy to Srila Prabhupada's books, that's my experience, practically each time, it's going to reflect back on whatever we are experiencing in life. The books will tell me, or tell anyone who reads, if we read it with empathy, the answer is there. It's like a gold mine. We are getting, gold is coming, and it's, if I am poor, I'm facing whatever experience of poorness I'm facing, when I read, I will get answers. That's my experience in many, many practical situations.
Thank you, Maharaj. Thank you for sharing that. Maharaj, I want to move to a slightly different aspect now. So far, you shared with us very elaborately the mood, how it's affected your life, and in terms of preaching, also institutionally for leaders and sannyasis, how it's important to read. Could you be spared a few minutes and you could share with us something about your personal reading habits? At the beginning of this conversation, you shared with us that you try to read every day. You also shared with us that yesterday night, you really wanted to finish, so you extended your time of rest. You slept a little, or you took rest a little later on. What are some of the tips or suggestions you can offer to devotees for good reading habits and how they can make reading an integral part of their lives?
The first thing, the most important, is to make it a priority. Like before, we were discussing the example of eating. The fact that somebody is very busy shouldn't prevent the person from eating. If the person doesn't eat, I remember one god brother of mine in some other place around the world was doing so much service that he stopped eating properly. And he became very ill, and he was a temple president. He had to stop altogether his service because his illness was so severe due to not paying attention to eating sufficiently. So reading is the same. We need to make it a priority, and that means we need to plan a time. What I do, I measure it. In management also, you know, you're a professional in professional life. You know about better than I that the lead, whatever we measure, this is what we develop. So it's important to keep control of how much we are reading, not for the sake of calculating numbers, but for the sake of ensuring that we are reading sufficiently. So,
yes, Maharaj.
I will say that's the priority. Then, in my case, of course, I travel, so I read in different places. Sometimes I read on the airplane. Sometimes I read at the airport while I'm waiting. I read in the car. Many times I read while traveling, because when I reach a place, there are many programs. Sometimes the schedule is packed. So I need to manage the time in a way that I can do the reading. Then when I'm in places like here in New Brajamandala, like for example, when I was going to, I mentioned before, a few months ago, I was going to teach we did Nectar of Devotion and Nectar of Instruction modules, I mean, as part of one of the modules of Bhakti Shastri. So, because I wanted to emphasize the importance of reading, because I find that sometimes also students, they don't read with sufficient depth, or sometimes students in the course because they are busy with other responsibilities, especially when they are not studying full time. So I thought, let us read together, and then I ensure they have done the reading. We are doing the reading together. So I'm doing the reading, you are doing the reading, and then we will have the class discussion. So we were doing this format. I found it, we had time because of the lockdown. So then let us use the time wisely. But yes, the main thing is to find our own formula for doing the reading. Especially for busy people, it is required to find the formula. And for people who are not so busy, there should be a cut of non-essentials. Like for example, navigating in social networks without substance, that will be one way of wasting time. Even within the devotee community, we may be navigating on the externals and not going to the substance, which is the message of Srila Prabhupada. So we need to be selective on that in order to don't waste the required time to do our daily eating by reading, eating, yes. Reading.
So we should prioritize. We should have a fixed formula of how we do it. And we maintain a discipline. And as you also said, we try to cut out the non-essentials. If we feel we're short of time, we cut out the non-essential to create that formula, create that time, and possibly increase our reading as well on a daily basis. Maharaj, what else would you like to share with the viewers in terms of your parting message on this important topic of reading Prabhupada's books every day?
There is a metaphor. It's a little story that I heard from, yes, one very nice devotee, a direct disciple, initiated disciple of Srila Prabhupada, His Grace Sadhya Shrestha Prabhu. He's a very exemplary grihastha, expert in yagyas. He was head putari for many years. He and his wife cooked for many, many years the Rajboga offering for Sri Sri Gauranitai in Barcelona, where they live. And they have been working, they have, in order to maintain their household, but they very, very exemplary in many ways. And he told a story of one disciple who approached a spiritual master and asked him, as the guru, I am reading, I'm hearing, but I do not remember anything. What is the benefit of it? And this is especially relevant for the age of Kali, in which many of us have short memories. So the guru told the disciple, they were next to a river. So told him, you see that basket? There was a basket full of coal. Coal, this mineral, black.
Yes.
The guru said, take out the coal and go with the basket. What's a kind of a straw basket, whatever type? And go to the river, fill it with water, and bring it here. The disciple tried several times to do that. He filled the basket. After emptied, he filled the basket with the clean water of the river and started to walk to the place where the guru was situated, but all the water was going out.
Yes.
So after several times, he went to the guru and said, Guru Maharaj, I'm very sorry, but each time I'm filling the water and following your instruction, but the basket is empty. And then the guru asked, what is the difference between the basket now and the basket before, in the beginning? Mm. And then he said, now it's totally clean. Before it was completely black. So So the Guru said, this is what exactly happens to your heart and your mind when you read every day Shastra. When we read Srila Prabhupada's books every day, we are cleaning. Even if we forget many things, it's there. It's cleaning the heart. And another important thing is use it or lose it. It's good we share what we are learning, share it with others. Yes. Make a program, can be a home program, can be with the family members, can be sharing with friends during breakfast, if we are eating with other devotees, or during lunch. But share whatever we are learning, share something with others. And this helps to make it even stronger within the heart.
Yes, Maharaj. So we understand that we should all try, and even if we can't see visibly the immediate effect from this analogy of the basket and the water, we can see that the cleansing is happening and its effect will become clear over a period of time, and that we can strengthen this by sharing it. So the programs that you're conducting in your Rajamandala and through your teachings is designed like this. I feel very inspired that as despite a busy schedule, you're spending time with the students, you're reading with them, you're sharing with them, you're nurturing them. And as you said, leaders should be readers. They should show by their example. So we feel very, very inspired. We feel very, very inspired by your example, Maharaj. We hope that we'll get more association, more time with you again in the future to hear from you more on how to read Srila Prabhupada's books and how to make Srila Prabhupada's books as the basis of our spiritual lives. Maharaj, we're celebrating this week ahead. Please give us some magical words that will inspire everybody within all of the centers and temples to read and share.
Yes, last night I received the poster. So I shared it to the forum of New Brajamandala. And yes. Tomorrow I'm scheduled to travel to Portugal. So most of my week will be in Portugal. But I told the devotees here, please take initiative and do something. And already one devotee who is, she is both a Mayapur resident and now a New Brajamandala resident, Her Grace Mahalakshmi Devi Dasi. She's here. She is going to organize after Sunday Aarti reading with the community of Srila Prabhupada's books to celebrate this Shravana week. So this is going to happen starting tonight. So let's do it wherever we are. Take some quality time for reading together.
Thank you,
the
Maharaj.
The family that reads spiritual literature together stays together.
Yes, yes. And Maharaj, we are so grateful for your time today. Thank you so very much for inspiring us, sharing with us. And we hope that we can imbibe some of your spirit and some of your instruction in our personal life, and that all the viewers and devotees will benefit greatly from your talk today and this discussion. And we hope to again hear from you, Maharaj. Thank you so much. And I wish you safe
Thank
travels
you very much.
For the pleasure of Srila Prabhupada, where you'll be sharing, using and sharing what you're reading every day. Thank you, Maharaj.
Thank you very much, Prabhu. Thank you very much.
All Hare glories Krishna. To Srila Prabhupada.
Jai Prabhupada. Hare Krishna.